First, let me lament the fact that we can ask any one of us in any room, I don't care what age you are, provided you're done with school, and ask, how many teachers, of all the teachers you've had in life? For most people, that would be like scores of teachers. You know, is it 70, 80, 100 teachers? Some, maybe as few as 50 or 40, but still in the high tens. Ask, among all your teachers, how many made a singular impact in your life? How many changed you in fundamental, important ways? Unfortunately, the answer to that question is almost always no more than this. 2, 3, at most 5. For me, that number is 3. And that's not unusual. So what gives here? By the way, they wouldn't have to be science teachers. I'm talking about teachers in any subject. And what makes those teachers special is that you could have no interest in the subject going in, and you come out, and it's the most interesting thing you've ever heard in your life. Those teachers convey something special within their students, an enthusiasm, an excitement, a passion. So one of my great laments is that education today seems to be less about passion and more about process, more about tactic or technique. But I don't know anybody who said, boy, I love that teacher. He or she gave a really good homework set. Or, boy, that was the best class I ever took because those exams were awesome. That's not what people want to talk about. That's not what influences people in one profession or another. It's how well the instructor imparted their passion for their subject in their students. And just extend this to the sciences. We all know people who were turned off by science because they had a bad teacher. That's the worst case. The teacher now has the opposite effect of what education ought to be. So I don't know what to do. Do we rifle through the educational system and like get rid of those teachers and clone the others? I don't have an easy silver bullet there. But I do know, but that shouldn't prevent me from citing at least part of what the problem is. I want to see more impassioned teachers than are currently out there. And if you can light a flame in a student, that's half the work. Isaac Newton, I mean, just look at, you read his writings. Hair stands up on, I don't have hair there, but if I did, it would stand up on the back of my neck. You read his writings, the man was connected to the universe in ways that I've never seen another human being connected. It's kind of spooky, actually. He discovers the laws of optics, figures out that white light is composed of colors. That's kind of freaky right there. If you take your colors of the rainbow, put them back together, you get white light again. That freaked out the artists of the day. How does that work? Red, orange, yellow, green, blue, violet gives you white. The laws of optics, he discovers the laws of motion and the universal law of gravitation. Then a friend of his says, well, why do these orbits of the planets, why are they in the shape of an ellipse, sort of flattened circle? Why aren't they some other shape? And he said, you know, I don't know. I'll get back to you. So it goes home, comes back a couple months later. Here's why. They're actually conic sections of a cone that you cut. And they said, well, how did you find this out? How did you determine this? Well, I had to invent integral and differential calculus to determine this. Then he turned 26. We've got people slogging through calculus in college just to learn what it is that Isaac Newton invented on a dare, practically. So that's my man. There's all this talk about investing in medical breakthroughs, predominantly through the National Institute of Health. That's the primary sort of government agency for medical research. What I caution is, fine, we all want to live healthy. No, that's not even here to debate. But keep in mind that if you take a tour through a hospital and look at every machine with an on-off switch that is brought into the service of diagnosing the human condition, that machine is based on principles of physics discovered by a physicist in a machine designed by an engineer. Nowhere in that equation was there a medical doctor or a medical researcher. And so you can't just fund one branch of scientific inquiry. You have to fund them all. Because these advances, for example, the MRI came from principles of physics discovered by a physicist who had no interest in medicine. That wasn't his point. That wasn't what drove him. Yet it has this marvelous application that we could diagnose or at least probe inside your body without cutting you open first. So the cross-pollination of disciplines is fundamental to truly revolutionary advances in our culture. And so you can't fund any one thing without the other, lest you believe you're right on top of a solution when in fact you're not. I have high hopes for where science will go under Obama. He's talked the talk, you know, so he's certainly scientifically literate in the sense that I think he understands issues related to global warming or the energy crisis or investments in the National Science Foundation and NASA. I think he has some sense of that. And he's been appointing reliable advisors in those circles. If you look at who he appointed for Secretary of Energy and his science advisor, these are talented, smart, accomplished scientists. So I have high expectations for where it can go. But we know the country's in a serious economic strait right now. So the challenge will be to see what is the balance between the Band-Aid you will put on the problem that you can sort of stop the hemorrhaging at this moment and the investments that you then insert that will return on that investment later. You need the combination of both. Without the longer-term investment, then you're just putting Band-Aids on as you go forward and nothing ever gets permanently solved. It gives the illusion of a solution, but it doesn't actually change what the manifestation of these problems as time moves on. I'd like to believe that science is becoming mainstream. It should have never been something that sort of geeky people do and no one else thinks about. Whether or not it will always be what geeky people do, it should as a minimum be what everybody thinks about, because science is all around us. And, you know, you get the people who are driving with their GPS in their car on their cell phone, now illegally, on their cell phone, saying, I don't need science. What do I need science for? I got my cell phone and my GPS. I'm fine. You know, I don't need space. Meanwhile, GPS is coming from satellites. Occasionally you get people who take the trappings of science for granted. And I have this secret plan. One day I'm going to sneak into someone's house and take away everything that's been discovered or enabled by the space program, for example, spun off from the space program. Just leave them back there and see how they enjoy life or how much of these innovations they take for granted. You only notice them when you don't have access to them anymore. And then you learn fast. Yes, I do. In fact, I was three times appointed by President Bush, twice to serve on commissions. These are sort of high-level gatherings of people with hand-picked expertise to bring their knowledge to bear on a problem that needs to be solved, that faces the nation. The first of those was on the future of the aerospace industry, which was on hard times back in the early part of this decade, the beginning of the 21st century. And also the future of NASA. These are the two commissions that I was appointed to. My third appointment was on the committee that selected the scientist who the president would award the Presidential Medal of Science to. This is the highest award the nation gives a scientist. So I'm there and I see it. And the stereotype of Bush being bad for science, if you ask someone, well, what do you mean by that? In essentially every case, they'll cite no more than two, maybe three occasions where Bush was bad for science. One was sort of stem cell research. Another one was sort of the environment. And that's kind of it, really. And okay, yeah, he wasn't good for these. There was a regression. Our advance in these fields regressed under Bush. But that's not the entire science portfolio of the nation. The portfolio of the nation includes, you know, the physics done under the Department of Education and the National Science Foundation and the National Institute for Health and NASA. There's a whole science portfolio that comes under the that comes under the Science Advisor's Office, the Office of Science and Technology Policy, OSTP. If you look at that portfolio, in fact, major monies were added to that portfolio over the Bush administration. The NIH budget went up. The NASA budget went up, although by less than many people wanted, given what's on its plate. In fact, the NIH budget nearly tripled over that time. The National Science Foundation budget went up. Meanwhile, under Clinton, President Clinton, over his 8 years, the budget for NASA, for example, dropped by 25% in actual spending power. So it's not accurate to characterize the Bush administration as being anti-science if you measure support for science by what's certain is that innovations and investments in science and technology are the engines of tomorrow's economic growth. That's a certainty. If we don't recognize that fact, certainly other developing nations do. So the extent to which we restrict our own investments in our own future, our own technological scientific future, is the extent to which we will no longer be players on the world economic stage. So one no longer has the luxury to think of science just as something that scientists do that keeps them entertained. You need to recognize it as that which separates nations that advance in their culture, in their economy, in their security, in their health, and nations that recede. So to whatever extent monies are reduced when they could have been higher, I'm disappointed in what that trend line might be. It would show an absence of foresight that is so desperately needed right now. If I put on my pure scientist hat, as opposed to my American scientist hat, pure scientist hat, I say, if we don't build the lab, somebody else will, and the science will get discovered. If we don't explore the moon, somebody else will. It will get discovered. That's one of the hallmarks of science that distinguishes it from art. In science, if you don't do it, somebody else will. Whereas in art, if Beethoven didn't compose the Ninth Symphony, no one else before or after is going to compose the Ninth Symphony that he composed. No one else is going to paint Starry Night by Van Gogh. So science, when done properly, is never owned by one nation or another. So that's what happened with particle physics in America. We were building the largest super collider there ever was, the superconducting super collider, to be based in Texas. 200-mile circumference ring. We would accelerate particles, smash them, and explore the conditions that were common in the early universe. That budget got canceled by Congress as we were winding down out of the Cold War. So no longer was the physicist the darling of the sciences the way they were after the Second World War going into the Cold War, because it was the innovations of physicists that created the bomb in the Manhattan Project. Physics basically ended the war. So without a war, certainly without a Cold War, there's a question as to what the value of the super collider was to the nation. Now, I don't know how many people you'd get to admit that fact, but my read of history is that when nations spend huge amounts of money on things, it's hardly ever for the pure value of exploration. There's usually secondary motives, primary motives that are presented secondarily, like military, like economics, or some other sort of factor that matters to national security. So what happened? Europe took up the task. So at CERN, which is the acronym for the Super Collider, the European Consortium Super Collider in Switzerland, they now have the most powerful collider in the world. And they're the ones who are going to be probing the conditions near the Big Bang, not us. So my pure scientist hat is, I don't care who does it as long as it's done, as long as somebody does it. The American scientist in me, because I'm born and raised in America and I care deeply for this nation, is I kind of prefer that we did it, because I know we can. If we weren't wealthy, or if we had I'd say, now's not the time. Let some other wealthier, more powerful nation do it than us. But is it time for me to say that? Are we really that poor? Are we really that without means? We have a $3 trillion budget to spend. It's about the balance of that portfolio of spending that makes a nation. How much do you spend on art, healthcare, poverty, research and development, the veterans, military? You lay out the portfolio, that is the country that you live in. And $3 trillion is enough to buy, as far as I'm concerned, anything we want, anything we choose to. And so I wish it were here, because if we make it here, the opportunities arise here. The engineering opportunities, the engineering solutions to problems we'd never seen before, that then create a climate and a landscape of innovation. That I remember growing up, America had like the longest bridge, the longest tunnel, the fastest planes. And for a while there, I thought, well, that's just bragging rights. What are you doing? And then I realized, in order to create the extremes of these technologies, you have to innovate. You can't just step there. It's hardly ever just make it a little longer. It's longer, so it's more stress on the structure. So we have to invent something new to accommodate this need or this desire. And therein are the seeds of innovation. I'd rather think that we'd be spending more energy learning how to live better. I'd rather start there and then worry about the longevity thing a little later. Part of knowing that you're going to die, not to get all philosophical on you, but knowing that you're going to die creates a certain focus on your activities in life in the present. If you knew you were going to live for 1,000 years, then at any moment you would say, well, what's my hurry? Why should I finish this manuscript today? Or why should I work late in the lab? I can just go home and watch the game. And so knowing that you lead a finite life creates a certain urgency to the minutes that you live that I value greatly. And I don't know what it would mean if we lived forever or lived a really long time. I don't know what it would mean for my focus. Maybe it's not, you have to be careful what you wish for here. Maybe if we live a long time, people become less productive than they do when they don't live very long at all. I think of the mayfly that lives no more than 24 hours. You know, what is life like to them? They'll never see a sunrise if they're born in the daytime. The things that we take for granted that they never see. So every minute of their life is, well, it's a wall, or it's a ceiling, it's a moon, it's a grass, everything is this life experience that's captured and presumably valued in their little brain. So I like to take my 75 years on this planet and be like the mayfly, thinking they're only living for a day, and just take it all in. Most religious people in America fully embrace science. So the argument that religion has some issue with science applies to a small fraction of those who declare that they are religious. They just happen to be a very vocal fraction, and so you get the impression that there's more of them than there actually is. It's actually the minority of religious people who reject science or feel threatened by it or want to sort of undo or restrict where science can go. The rest, you know, are just fine with science and has been that way ever since the beginning. And by the way, there's no tradition of scientists knocking down the door, the Sunday school door, telling the preacher what to teach. There's no tradition of scientists picketing outside of churches, nor should there be some emergent tradition of religious fundamentalists trying to change the curriculum in the science classroom. There's been a happy coexistence for centuries, and for that to change now would be unfortunate, because I've seen this happen in other nations and other states, where the consequences are that you just basically recede back to the cave, because that's where you land when you undermine the scientific and technological innovations that come about when you're a properly trained scientist or technologist. Consider also that in America, 40% of American scientists are religious. So this notion that there's some, that if you're a scientist, you're an atheist, or if you're religious, you're not a scientist, that's just empirically false. It's an empirically false statement. And what I mean by religious is you can pose the question in a way that is unambiguous. You don't ask, well, do you go to church every Sunday? Because plenty of people go to church like just for the pie, you know, or the social scene after the service. You ask people, do you pray to a personal God? If you say yes to that, you're religious by presumably anybody's standards of your conduct. And it's the yes to that question that applies to 40% of scientists. So while there are plenty of atheists who are scientists or not scientists, to paint this as some built-in conflict is, there may be a conflict, but plenty of people in this country coexist in both worlds. For me, the most fascinating aspect of the Pluto Files was watching the depth of emotion that people brought to bear on what they would believe to be the scientific reason for why they hold those thoughts, for why they have those beliefs. So in other words, you would say, I think Pluto is a planet. Well, why? And then they'd give a list of scientific reasons, but they'd be like weak reasons. They'd be, because I watched it happen. I watched it. So people would say, Pluto's a planet. Why? Well, because it has a moon, and planets have moons. And then a few years later, we found that an asteroid had a moon. And so they couldn't use that argument anymore because it was an unimpeachably little potato-shaped asteroid. And so they have to sort of abandon that. And you say, well, Pluto, and just to watch arguments come and go. And you realize that at the end of the day, it's all about people's emotions. Not all, but predominantly. And I was intrigued by this because it's emotions that drives art. Rational thoughts never drives people's creativity the way emotions do. And so the controversy jumped species, and it went out of the scientific community, out of the classroom, and landed in the laps of humorists, of cartoonists, of op-ed writers who write humorous op-eds. And everybody took a piece of Pluto. Death by Black Hole is a collection of my essays that I'd written over 10 years for Natural History magazine. And there's the title essay called Death by Black Hole in a section titled When the Universe Turns Bad, All the Ways the Cosmos Wants to Kill Us. It talks about gamma ray bursts and asteroid strikes and that sort of thing. But by and large, in spite of that title, the book is predominantly about how science works, with sections titled The Nature of Discovery and The Discovery of Nature, the how we've come to learn what we know about the universe. And so I've gotten very good feedback, very positive feedback on that book, because people, it's not just telling you what to know, it's empowering you how to think about the physical world. And about that, I'm proud that I've succeeded in that way. It was a side benefit that I had not anticipated. I thought that as a minimum, I teach a little bit about black holes and the universe, but people have deeply appreciated and resonated with the rest of what the book is, which allows you to take on a little bit of the lens that so many scientists take for granted. It's the lens of curiosity folded with the lens of the empowerment of a thought. This is not simply what to know about the universe, it's how to think about the universe. So you can go on and feel more connected than you ever had been before. I want to write a book on the educational system, how best to train people to think. To be scientifically literate, I think, is important, something we're lacking in school. We think science literacy flows out of, well, how many science facts can you recite, rather than how is your brain wired for thinking. And it's the brain wiring that I'm more interested in, rather than the facts that come out of the curriculum or the lesson plan that's been proposed.
One last comment on Richard Dawkins. It'll be quick. I was in the back row as you spoke, and so I could see sort of a whole room as the words came out of your mouth as beautifully as they always do and as articulately as they always do. And let me just say, your commentary had a sharpness of teeth that I had not even projected for you. It was my first time meeting him, and so I felt you more than I heard you. And I ask the question, and this gets back a little to what Francisco was getting at. You're a professor of the public understanding of science, not professor of delivering truth to the public. And these are two different exercises. One of them is you put the truth out there, and like you said, they either buy your book or they don't. Well, that's not being an educator. That's just putting it out there. Being an educator is not only getting the truth right, but there's got to be an act of persuasion in there as well. Persuasion isn't always, here's the facts, you're either an idiot or you're not. It's here are the facts, and here is a sensitivity to your state of mind, and it's the facts plus the sensitivity, when convolved together, creates impact. And I worry that your methods and how articulately barbed you can be ends up simply being ineffective when you have much more power of influence than what is currently reflected in your output.
I gratefully accept the rebuke. I just one anecdote to show that I'm not the worst in this thing. A former and highly successful editor of New Scientist magazine, who actually built up New Scientist to great new heights, was asked, what is your philosophy at New Scientist? And he said, our philosophy at New Scientist is this: science is interesting, and if you don't agree, you can fuck off.